if they can establish an offense that was really held down, minus one pass yards. You just don't find that very often.
Well, I think they only attempted a few passes. They weren't really trying to pass it much. But again, the problem, again, as we see it, that they were two for five in passing. And again, there's not a lot of attempts. But the key is they come out. It's first and 10. You've got to reduce the yardage in your type of offense. And they've done absolutely nothing positive on first down.
West Virginia trying to get some good field position. They haven't had a whole lot of that as Miles is now trying to return kicks, and he only gets it out to the 22 yards. And moments ago, our Trenty Kuznarek spoke with West Virginia coach Rich Rodriguez.
Well, Coach Rod, how do you jumpstart this offense, and does it start with not making foolish penalties?
Well, obviously the penalties are killing us at times. We just got to execute. We're close at times. We just got to put some drives together, give our defense a break a little bit, and try to control the ball, our offense a little bit.
All right, thanks very much. Best of luck in the second half, guys.
All right, Trenty, thank you very much. Adam Bednarik comes back to play quarterback. He sat out much of the second quarter while Pat White played. See if Bednarik can get this team going. And a planned draw that just backfired.
And that was a great drive by the Louisville defensive line.
That is Amobi Okoye on the stop. And more about Okoye in just a moment. We have our Pacific Life game summary first. And they already hit on one of the statistics that's probably the minus one passing yards. But Louisville just utterly dominant. I think that's an honest assessment of that first half. The one Louisville turnover made by Lorello, the West Virginia State Bandit back. But otherwise, West Virginia's got to find a way, and starting out with a loss of six is not the way to do it.
Nice option out to Steve Slayton on second down. Another late flag, though. Let's see what happens here.
Okoye again. I want to talk about Okoye just for a second, number 91. As soon as we find out about the penalty, he's something unusual about him. And this is going against West Virginia again.
Every time they have a good play, something positive, a penalty.
You see Okoye there. Briefly going by the officials. He's only 18 years old. He is 6'3", 315 pounds. Started playing NCAA football at 16.
And I'm waiting for the official to make the call here, if he
I think
will.
He's holding, Terry.
Did he get through with it?
Holding. Number 21 on the offense. 10-yard penalty from the spot of the foul. Repeat second down.
You know, but Okoye, he was at Louisville at 16. Remember all the arguing about should somebody be able to play in the NFL?
Yeah.
And I'm thinking, here's a guy 16 years old looking like a man playing in college. You know, I'm not sure whether it's right or wrong, but don't tell me every now and then somebody's going to come along with the physical skills to play in the NFL at 18 years old or 19 years old.
You saw it just a moment ago. Darryl Jalloh, he's the one who committed the penalty and really puts them in a major hole. Second down and 20. They go to the screen to try to reduce some of the pressure with Slayton, and he showed a good burst there to get it across the 15 to about the 18-yard line before Montavious Stanley sat on it.
When you're playing behind the chains like they are right now, penalties put you behind the chains. These are positive plays, a 7-yard gain, 6-yard gain. Those are nice gains, but they're not helping you at all because your penalties have put you so far back.
Five penalties. It seems like it only says here 5 for 55 for West Virginia. It seems like
they've
so
all been
many
critical.
More.
They've all been 15 or 10 on first down to get you with long yardage.
Third down, about 15. Elvis coming in, forcing Bednarik out. And down he goes. Thrown to the turf by Nate Harris, the junior linebacker. And another flag. And this is in the secondary. So we might have defensive holding on the Cardinals. That'd be the biggest break West Virginia has had in a while, and that's exactly the case.
Well, the quarterback scrambled outside, and now you got to stay on your receiver.
Holding, number 97 on the defense, 10-yard penalty from the line of scrimmage. Repeat third down.
Anytime your quarterback breaks contain, now your receiver's got lots of time to get open.
Take a look at Elvis Dumervil, and he's one of the reasons they get out of the Bednarik get out of the pocket. He does not have a sack yet today, though.
Well, I mean, that's the sixth pass. I think the sixth or seventh pass of the game. Hasn't been a lot of opportunity. But this, everybody's covered. Everybody's covered. Nothing to, no, nowhere to go with the ball. But thank goodness for West Virginia, an opportunity now for them, although the penalty did not give them the automatic first down.
Nope, it's going to be third down and 5, but at least it's a lot better than the second and 20 they were looking at a couple of plays ago. See if they have the means to get the first down. Big blitz coming from the back. Bednarik steps up, throws, and he's got his man. First down to the 40-yard line, and another flag comes in. That's Renaud on the catch.
Renaud did a great job of coming back for the ball. Indications early on Louisville. If Renaud has anything to do with it.
Boy, Brandon Johnson grabbed the official, is trying to make a point there. He's lucky he didn't get in trouble. This will be pass interference, and that will go against Louisville. So I imagine West Virginia will take the play and take the first down and try to get a drive going, something they have not been able to do.
Again, here's the crossover to try to get the switch. Renaud going outside now. A little bit thrown behind him. Not a great throw. Dangerous throw, but great
pass
catch.
Pass interference, number 38 on the defense. Penalty is declined. Result of the play, first down.
That's Deion Palmer, number 38 on coverage. It's only the fourth West Virginia first down of the game. I'll be honest, I didn't quite see that call, but it doesn't really matter either.
No, they declined and got the catch.
The one thing lacking today for the Mountaineers offensively has been any kind of sustained drive.
First down's been the key. Let's see if they get anything going on first down.
They go to Slayton, and they do this time. He gets near to the first down as he's flipped out of bounds, finally, by Rod Council, the redshirt freshman cornerback. But that's a good gain on first down, something that they weren't doing in the first half.
Well, they only made four first downs in the first half. It's a first down there. That's a positive for Temple Bay. But, again, when they got possession of the ball, would be another first down. That's the key to this ball game for West Virginia. Steve Slayton right here. What he brings to the table is speed. He has more speed than any other back for West Virginia. And it's that speed that made that first down play successful.
Great block by the fullback, Owen Schmidt, number 35. He'll try to lead the traffic. Slayton cuts back, finds the hole, gets across the 45 to the 44-yard line before Antoine Sharp, the senior, brings him down. You see Antoine playing with his brother Brandon, who is a junior.
West Virginia's not out of this ball game. All they need to do is come out here, be the first guy to put points on the board. If I'm the head coach, and I'm in the dressing room at halftime, I'm saying, men, let's get the first score. Let's come out, get the first score, and we're back in this ball game.
Second down and four. They've got to get right to the 40-yard line. And Bednarik sees something. He'll change the play. Got time to snap it. 8 seconds. Got a stretch to Slate. Good. A good block. Cuts back. First down and a whole lot more for Slate. Gang tackle out of bounds inside the 20. Brandon Johnson among others. But that is the best play for West Virginia today.
Isn't it amazing? It's almost like a light bulb. Light switch came on. A light bulb came on. Look at the angle now. Watch the back. Stretch the zone play. One of their favorite plays, the zone play. He's looking for a hole to cut into. There's the hole. Outruns the defender now using his speed. Stays inbound. Got the ball inside the 20. Now they're in the red zone.
27-yard gain. First time the Mountaineers have been this deep in Louisville territory today. 26 yards, we'll call it, to about the 18-yard line. Slate crosses the 15-yard line. Well, he really had his breakout performance, Terry, last week against Rutgers when he ran for 139 yards.
Well, he finally had his breakout game. He's been sharing time, and boy, had a breakout game against Rutgers. It was a rainy day, a wet day. You couldn't throw it. They had to depend on the run. He came out, had a great day running the football. And he gives them the deep threat possibility out of the backfield.
That was the most yards run for by a freshman since 1999. Avon Coburn did that. Bednarik under some heat and bounced that pass in there, incomplete. Bring up third down and six. Trying to get that to Brandon Miles. He was well covered. Well, we talked about the first half of Louisville slowly began to dominate the game. And one of the problems is West Virginia couldn't get out of their own way offensively.
Well, you know, Louisville needed three and outs. Look at there, five series, three and out. There's three plays. Three of the five times it was three and out, three and out, three and out. And that's what you want to do is get them off the field quickly.
And somebody who may just be joining us and say, what happened to 8 plays and 13 yards? Penalties killed West Virginia in their first drive. Big third down here. Up at the Slate. He's got a blocker. Got a chance. Got a touchdown.
Testing. One, two, testing.
For the first time today, a reason for Joy in Morgantown, 14 yards on the catch by Slayton.
Just like that, West Virginia back in this ballgame. Fans are on their feet. A lot of excitement now as they feel like they've got something going.
Pat McAfee on for the PAT. He'll tack that point on, and all of a sudden we got a ball game. But now, here comes Louisville's offense. They really began to click late in that second quarter. We'll find out if that time off and some momentum from West Virginia will slow down the Louisville Cardinal attack. As you see Slayton score for the Mountaineers. And that was the Steve Slayton drive for West Virginia. He had 5 rushes, 52 yards, 2 catches for 19, and the touchdown, coach. And just like you said, Mountaineers had to come out right away, and they did.
Well, they averaged 220 yards rushing a game. They're very good running the football. Offensive line coach Rick Trickett does a great job of getting those guys ready, and they just haven't been able to do anything on first down. And I said earlier, if they can just make positive plays on first down, it changes everything.
Kicking into the wind, they'll kick it low, and this is out of bounds. So good field position automatically for the Louisville Cardinals. We had an injury on that touchdown. It appeared to be Josh Bailey, the starting tight end. Trenny, what do you have for us on that?
Well, guys, Josh Bailey has left the game with a low left leg injury. He has gone into the locker room for x-rays. I asked the trainer when he was hurt. He said about 3 or 4 plays before that touchdown. They have now taken him, as I said, to the locker room for x-rays, guys.
All right, thank you, Trenny. And he was having a tough time getting in there. Now, Terry, the kick out of bounds, that's just another penalty West Virginia doesn't need.
Yeah, and it's a mistake you don't make. You're gonna squib kick it. You're going to kick it low because of the wind. Then kick it between the hashes. That the object is you want to keep them down deep. If you want to kick it in the air, if you want to give them 35 yards. And so, again, another mental mistake for West Virginia. They've been very good in the kicking game so far this year.
Now this crowd back into it here in Morgantown. Brahm, and they get it out to Irrutia. This time really seen much out of him. He has not had the big play. Got about 5 on that one. Let's go back to the West Virginia touchdown pass from Bednarik to Slayton.
Again, this line for West Virginia, pass protection. There's the quick swing. The screen is a quick swing. Look at the kick out block right there. Great kick out block by West Virginia to lead to the score.
Well, you have Travis Garrett there. Terry, he's 305 pounds. William Gay is, about a 200-pounder on a good day. So I think that battle is going to be won by the big man every time. And West Virginia's defense beginning to bow up a little bit. Dykes on the stop of Bush at the 40-yard line. Barely a yard on that play. Here comes a 3rd down and 5.
I'm going to tell you, this is the biggest 3rd down so far, this play. Again, West Virginia gave up some critical 3rd downs right before the half to lead with the score.
7 out of 11 3rd downs for the Cardinals in the first half.
Again, the Cardinals have been effective throwing it over the middle in these situations. They're inside receivers going over the middle, hooking up or dragging across.
They bring the blitz. Brahm throws, has his man, and that is Tinch. He's had a spectacular day. He has another 1st down.
Well, a great change up there for Brian Brahm.
And that for Tinch is his 10th catch of the ball game. He has had an unbelievable day. I'm Dave Lamont. Terry Bowden with us. We're upstairs.
The squad with a great kick out block on the screen.
Well, Brown's got plenty of time. There's that throw down the middle, and there's a great catch into West Virginia territory. And that is Lorello on the stop, and looks like Tinch again. It is. That's his 11th catch, and he's over 100 yards. 2nd down and 4. West Virginia rose up, got their 1st points of the ballgame on their opening drive. Now Michael Bush in the Cardinal offense. And yeah, he's had 2 rushes and really hasn't gotten anything for it. McClee and Henry in there for the Mountaineers. So here comes another big 3rd down.
Another big 3rd down play again. Watch the defensive surge right here. The penetration now. They've got the ball, but the offensive line of scrimmage right now has been moved backwards. Michael Bush finds no holes to work through for the 1st down.
Heavy substitution for the Mountaineers on 3rd down and 4 on the defensive side. But Brahm has been so calm, they've hit 75% of their 3rd downs. Including 1 for 1 in this possession. The middle, trying to get there. Brahm trying to get to the 1st down. He's not fast. It's close. It is very close. Dee McCann came up from his cornerback position at a right around the 45-yard line. They had to get to the 44. And it looks like they will take timeout for a measurement.
Brian Brahm knows where his 1st down is. He's coming here now. Again, no falling on the ground, no running out of bounds. He knows exactly where the sticks are, lowers his shoulder even if he doesn't make it, even if he doesn't, they now have the decision they may want. Hey, do we go for it, mm-hmm. or do we kick him deep? But I think because he stuck it up there, they had a chance. It looked like it's going to be close.
Todd Flannery, their punter, has put three inside the 20-yard line this season.
I don't believe he made it.
He didn't. Oh. All right. Interesting call here. The conservative way of doing it for Bobby Petrino. Go ahead and punt. You're up by 10 points. The go-for-it way says, I've got Michael Bush and you don't. And I don't see a punter.
Interesting call now. Let's see. Think first the thing you think of, is he going to try to pull the defense offside?
Right.
Does he take one shot at that, then call a timeout and make your decision whether to go for a punt? So let's see if the first time it's more try to pull him off. You would think every coach on the WFGU sideline is yelling, watch the snap count, watch the snap count. Don't want to pull you off sides.
So Louisville, play clock has not even started yet, so they've got time.
That big number, 19 in the backfield, Michael Bush.
Sitting right there, too. They fake Brom. That's the first down. Very calmly and still fighting all the way for the extra yard is Scott Kuhn, third-string tight end at 6'5", and 255 pounds, the sophomore. And it got quiet here, didn't it?
Yeah, because, you know, they took everything. They faked the dive. They faked. He's the reason they had a chance to get that first down.
Now he'll fire the out pattern. Misses man, incomplete. Trying to get it that time. The number 86, Montrell Jones. Mentioned earlier that he played for the Volunteers, played for Phil Fulmer. Rich Rodriguez now, something got on him, and he is really working his guys.
Trying to fire those kids up. He's trying to get them fired up right now, see what kind of got the guy inside of them. That's what he does. He knows if he can stop them this game, he's got a ball game. He had momentum, and now he needs to stop them. They've made third downs and a fourth down.
There is Pat Liebig in today, starting in place of the injured Ernest Hunter. Second and 10. Again, play action and hold on. We've got whistles. We've got trainer running on the field. We've got all sorts of action.
They call timeout there before the play? Yeah.
They did.
It's their first time out of the half.
So with 7:53 to go in the third quarter, West Virginia has livened things up here in Morgantown with a touchdown. Now, can their defense stop one of the most explosive offenses? Field in the shadows now. Louisville leads West Virginia 17-7, an important Big East battle. West Virginia came in today 2-0 in the conference. Louisville 0-1. Trying to win one on the road in the conference after an embarrassing loss to South Florida 2 weeks ago. They may have recovered from it.
If you're the Mountaineers, you got to do it here. You got to do it right here.
Brom, there's that middle again. Broken up by a dive.
That's what you got to do.
Well, Henry Douglas had it until a dive met him. Third down and 10 coming up. We talked about him as a hitter.
Jamil Adai, he can hit you. Watch from behind the quarterback. He sees the open receiver over the middle. He's open. Brom throws the perfect pass. It's in the hands. But number four, Jamil Adai, best hitter on this football team, makes the contact. Is that the play that excites this defense? Because now this is where there's got to be a stop.
Third down, 10, 8 of 13, the Cardinals on third down. Brom, trying to direct traffic with his lineman. Should have a false start penalty. Yep, left tackle move.
Absolutely, absolutely.
It'll be third and 15.
And again, a false start. Now the short middle is not as dangerous. You know, you got 15. Mm-hmm. You give up about 7 or 8 in the middle. Just don't give up 15.
In case you're wondering, Arthur Carmody's longest kick of the season, 42 yards.
Prior to the snap, neutral zone infraction. Number 43 on the defense. 5-yard penalty. Remains third down.
I was amazed. I have not seen.
Well, there he is.
Right there, 43. Excuse me, there. Right there, 43. There he is coming across.
Yep, Dave.
Excellent play by the center. What you have, the center noticed that the defender had stepped into the neutral zone and he snapped it. All we could see was the procedure by the offensive lineman. Great call by the officials.
Third down and 5. That's Eric Wood, a redshirt freshman center with a heads-up play, making it maybe a little bit easier for the Cardinals. They'll go to Bush. And he will try to dive for the chain, and this is going to be another, I think, fourth down and very short. Another interesting decision. Now, I think you got to go for it here. Why not?
Oh, I mean, just, I mean, you got Michael Bush. I mean, you got the, that size of that guy. I don't think there's any question right here. You got a chance to put the nail in the coffin.
There you see the signals from Petrino, but those may be dummies. There's usually about two or three guys who handle signaling on the sidelines.
And again, first thing you think is try to pull them off. See if they try to pull them off.
Last time they went to the air on fourth and one. This time the conventional method, Bush. It looks like he made it. He got all the way to the 27. First down, Louisville.
In college.
Although this team here in the white not doing too badly. Brom, they really got in on him that time. Lorello had some help. Looked like Eric Wicks was the other blitzer. You take a good look at Wicks right there. He's come in several times. You complained that the pressure wasn't getting there fast enough. This time it did.
But this is when a guy knows how to be a quarterback. He knows how to play quarterback. There's nothing there. Get back up and just throw it away. Don't take a sack. He naturally knows how to be a quarterback. He's a true sophomore. He's only been in college 2 years. He played a little bit last year behind Stephon LaFleur. And now he's the starter as a true sophomore, making very, very mature decisions.
Second and 10. One of the deep shot, and said he'll just take the first down. And that is Arutia. Gets it down to inside the 15 to the 12-yard line. Adai, one of the tacklers for the Mountaineers, and also like McClee is the guy at the bottom.
And that, well, they worked all week on that game plan, and now get out of the game plan, go to phase two. 17-7, get out of the game plan, go to phase two, get in their face a little bit more.
Gets the snap off just in time. Well, Bush has the fullback leading him here. I tell you what, run out of bounds that time by Dean McCann. Otherwise, that's a touchdown. It was that time. Good lead opportunity for Devontae Taylor.
You know, I have not seen from Jaguars. That's where Bobby Petrino was.
Second down and two. LeFue, 78, had a big block on that last play, too. Bush finds his hole, finds the end zone. He's done it again. His second touchdown of the game for Michael Bush. Big block by Jason Spitz that time, Coach. 4 yards for the school.
Yeah, West Virginia came out of the halftime, answered the bell, scored a touchdown. Louisville says, you know what? If we're going to be a champion, a contender again, we got to answer them back. Trenches by Louisville.
PAT is good, and the crowd that was so fired up about 10 minutes ago has retreated into the silent shadows here in Morgantown. Now, can West Virginia recover? They just got punched in the mouth by number 19, Louisville. We're up there. Wave to the folks at home there, Terry, as you take a good look at Milan Pushkar Stadium, I should say, in Mountaineer Field in Morgantown, West Virginia. An absolutely beautiful day, particularly if you're a fan of the Louisville Cardinals. They lead this game 24-7 over. There's one of the reasons why. Michael Bush.
He needs to sit down and rest. He's run for a West Virginia country mile so far in this game, and had some leg cramps as he came out, but I mean, he's the reason everything else is working. I mean, Brian Brom's done great. So is Joshua. There's the kick.
Tinch.
I'm sorry, Joshua.
No,
Tinch,
that's all right. Renaud there, takes about a step into the end zone, trying to find a hole. Looks like for a second he had an opportunity. Then he just gets game tackled at the 25-yard line. Score on the opening drive of the third quarter. Tough play here for Bednarik, and from the backside, Elvis got him. Elvis Dumerville, who's been a fairly quiet day, was also assisted by Nate Harris. Looks like Preston Smith was around there too, and Bednarik, who's had some injuries in some of these games for the Mountaineers, gets up a little slowly.
Well, yeah, your first down, they're trying to get some big plays on first down. They had a two-receiver route. Fake the play, run the fullback in the flat, run the curl by the wide receiver. Both players covered perfectly.
No gain.
No gain on first down.
That's been a problem, except for the good drive.
That's right, except for the good drive. Now there's the outside slip screen.
And they read it fairly well. That time, Nate Harris, one of the tacklers. Also, number 97, Brandon Johnson, all over Vaughn Rivers, number 19. Excuse me, that was actually Steve Slayton. Vaughn Rivers. That is Harris, number 10, for Louisville.
Great defensive play there also. Avoided the block on the slip screen and stopped it for a short gain.
Third down and 7. West Virginia, 3 of 8 third downs today. Time running out. There's Elvis. That's 16 or maybe 15 and a half. He'll probably share that one.
Well, I knew if you eventually got back and tried to pass it too much, you're going to get sacked. I know Elvis is going to be in this one.
Oh, yeah. Okoye and Stanley also. You don't divide sack. Brady into that breeze, which has died down a little bit. This is a pretty good high kick. Fair catch taken. Look at the field position, though, for Louisville at the 42-yard line. Like, this offense needs that kind of help. And Montrell Jones wisely takes the field position. They're going to call that down at the 43-yard line.
And that's been the storyline, too. Other than the good drive West Virginia had coming out of the half, they've had a lot of three and outs. They have to punt from backed up. Gives Louisville the ball midfield. They do a long drive. West Virginia gets the ball. Has to do a three or four out. Punt again. So Louisville always has the ball.
We're going to give Elvis Dumervil a half a sack. Look how far ahead he is of his nearest competitors.
I mean, he's putting up some phenomenal numbers. And I might add, too, he's also about ready to break an NCAA record for caused fumbles also.
Yep.
He sacks people, and he also causes fumbles.
He's got seven, and the record is eight. Well, they could be taking the big shot right here, but it's well covered by the Mountaineers. And Brom's going to have to try to get to the sidelines before they kill him. And he couldn't quite get it done. Good defense and pursuit that time by the Mountaineers' Mark McGrow. Well, nine. Always a good move to give it to Bush, and he only got about a yard that time. Again, Magro, the sophomore, getting an opportunity to play in that middle linebacker position with Jay Henry taking a rest. Bush was being treated for some cramps during the West Virginia possession, and he's going to come out now.
Yeah, Louisville took a stab at a deep ball on first and 10. You saw how the game's being played out. There was no way they were going to throw the deep ball. West Virginia was so far back. They took a stab at it. That's why the middle passing game has been open so much, and that's why they have had so much success throwing the ball over the middle.
Empty backfield for Brom on third and eight. 8 of 14 on third downs, but Louisville's also popped a couple of fourth downs on that last drive. They pick up the blitz. There's the middle. Pass was deflected. That pass was tipped, and West Virginia got a three and out they desperately had to have.
Now I'm anxious to see how they respond now offensively as they come in. And will they stay with Adam Bednarik or go to Pat White, the other quarterback on their team?
Take a look at Lorello there, who was, as always, right around the ball. Vaughn Rivers is the return man for the Mountaineers. Todd Flannery mentioned earlier he has had one punt blocked.
West Virginia got one last week against Syracuse. West Virginia blocked a punt that went for a touchdown.
Tandy Smith did that against Rutgers last week, and he's kind of creeping off the gunner position. Now he goes to the block. And, close to hitting the punter. Pretty good kick. Rivers to 10. Rivers, that's a good return of 15 yards that time by Vaughn Rivers. Gives West Virginia decent field position at the 25-yard line. Yeah, I imagine you'll probably find a way to watch that, won't you?
I imagine so.
You dragged us to watch Tommy's game the other night.
That's right. Tommy had a big win for Clemson.
4-yard gain that time for Slayton. He's been impressive. Tell me what you think of Steve Slayton.
Well, what he does is give them a chance to have big plays with their running attack. Now, this team needs some speed and big plays out of their wide receivers, or they're not going to develop as an offense. But what Slayton does give them is a chance to get 15 and 20-yard slashes with that running attack instead of 6 and 7 that they've gotten out of their other backs. So that's one more piece of the puzzle. But the passing attack, again, from what I've seen, is not quite there.
He has 95 yards on the ground today and a touchdown catch. Hit as he throws, and that is nearly intercepted. He tried to sell that one, Rod Council, but no take.
Yep, and Bednarik takes a slap in the mouth right here as the pressure gets to him right now as he comes up, and here's a slap right in the void. Took it to the ground, and again, missed the slant, wide open slant. Pressure.
Montavious Stanley. Funny thing is with him, with Stanley, Coach, he has four sacks. Normally that would be, four sacks. But again, with Elvis Dumervil, 15 and a half.
Yeah,
it just
seconds.
Doesn't look good.
Distant second.
Third down, six. Actually, he probably got a half a sack on that last one there. Under pressure. Got his man. That's a first down. That is Renaud. And let's get an update on Michigan and Penn State. We'll go to New York. All right, John, well,
Joe,
how about
Paul
it?
Joe Paul is on his way.
How about those two coaches at the top of the wins list just doing nothing but winning so far this year?
Well, you don't really do your best coaching until you're over 75 years old.
Is that the deal?
That's the key, is just keep on going to get 75, then you get a lot better. Of course, you got to have some of them 18-year-olds that can play, and Joe Paul's got some of those.
Brandon Sharp on the stop. Yeah, how about that new approach? He's always been so careful about that, and he said, okay, you know what?
We're going to spread it. Well, you know what happened? You know, he did that 2 years ago, but he was spreading out fullbacks and tight ends. Right. Now he's got some sleek wideouts to spread out, and they're moving that ball. And Michael Robson played only one position helps.
Bednarik forced to throw that one away. Good pressure that time from Louisville defensively. It's like Zach Anderson chasing him down there and brings up.
And Mark Bulger. They've had Hosteller. They've had some great ones, too.
Heavy pressure. They go to the bubble screen. Tipped around. Caught the other way, but not for the first down. After all of that, it winds up in the hands of a lineman, Ryan Stanchek. Well, I thought that was going to be picked, and that might have been a near-death blow for the Mountaineers.
Let's check it out. Now, here's a throw. Adams throwing the ball. Reflected up in the air.
Brandon Johnson there. How about Stanchek?
How about Stanchek? That's an offensive lineman's dream. Here's the tip. Here's the pick. It's up in the air. It's the immaculate reception.
Well.
Right there. Not exactly.
That happened not far from here.
Not far from here.
All right, they're going for it here. Fourth down and a couple. Last play of the quarter. Bednarik's got room. Throws to the middle, and his man was covered. The pass was tipped incomplete. I thought he might have brought that down to run it. The fans want interference, but because the ball was tipped, they're not going to get it. Trying to hit the tight end, Michael Villagrana, who's replaced the injured Josh Bailey. And Louisville will take over on downs with great field position and only 14 seconds left in the third quarter.
Tough. This tough play. Everybody was covered. Louisville did a great job. They know they're going to pass. A little play action trying to get somebody open, but everybody had somebody closely contested. You would hope maybe Adam would have had some room to run for four or five, but they also had people in his face. Great job by Louisville right there, not to let one slip up on him. Now, again, the time and pressure back on the Mountaineers.
Wonder if they take a deep shot here. Nope. They go with Bush, trying to get in the corner. He does, and he will get about 8 solid yards to pad his total as he gets to close to 130 yards, and we are finished with our third quarter. ABC Sports presentation of college football will return after this message and a word from our ABC station.